Morning, church. So we're doing things a little bit differently. And by the way, you know, Jen is away on a
ski trip with the youth group. He'll be back tomorrow. So to remind you that this is the season of Lent, and we're trying a couple of things that are different. Number one is that there will be periods of silence following the sermon and other places for you to reflect on what you've heard. Number two is that today we're going to say the Great Litany, which is going to be chanted in procession. And I think you've done this sometime before in the past, but it's a dramatic way to be encircled by the choir and the sound of this Great Litany as a reminder of the whole focus of Lent, which is to make some changes in our lives, to be grateful for God's presence, and to realize that this is a sacred, sacred season of the year. We have some announcements. First of all, let's hear about the Connected campaign from head of school.
Good morning. Thank you to my able assistant here, Bonnie Zacherly, as well, who's also an artist, which you will see. So I know this is not what you were expecting this morning during announcements, but as a former teacher and a head of school, I'm going to give you a little quiz. First of all, can you raise your hand if you were a parishioner in 1982? I'm not trying to age anybody, I promise. Look around. Thank you. Thanks to each of you. Do you know what you did? Any ideas? Collectively, you and others began St. James Preschool. The idea to start the preschool did not come from a group outside of these walls. It came from a rector and parishioners. Parishioners who became a director, who became teachers, who wrote curriculum, asked their friends to join them in this endeavor, and ultimately filled the classrooms with children. This church has remained the backbone of the school, and the church started this school, and we thank you for creating us, for supporting us, and ultimately giving us room to grow. Over the last few weeks, you've heard from speakers, such as 90, about the benefits of the Capital campaign. And when you view our student speak video next week from the weekly email, you'll hear what our students are most excited about. A new defined entrance, bright and airy classrooms, more space to move around in. And if we asked our parents, I think they would say a more safe and efficient arrival and dismissal. And probably we all would say we're looking forward to more parking. Our new and improved 5 classrooms will house our 1st through 5th grade, and our new entrance will house the elevator that will benefit all 3 floors for our community. Did you know when the education wing was built 50 years ago, there were 309 parishioners? Today, there are 898 people who call St. James home, and over 400 of them had some sort of tie to the school. We've had a 5th grade for the past 3 years, and we know our enrollment will begin to level off and remain steady. But the numbers for the church can continue to grow. We're truly a benefit to one another. Back to our quiz, we have a quick trick question for you. Edison, 64,827 plus 40,000, what does that equal? Not trying to put you on the spot, we'll show you. The first answer, of course, is 104,827. But the answer we want you to know is this number represents the total amount that the school paid to the church last year, both in way of tithe and shared cost. Quiz question number 2. What is 123 plus 86? The quick answer is 209. But the number also represents the number of preschoolers and elementary students who experience Episcopal traditions daily. And now a word problem. I did share with the 8 o'clock, I was an English teacher, not a math teacher. So take this with a grain of salt. But if 9 5th graders each complete a service project before they graduate, and the school and church jointly sponsor monthly service projects throughout the school year, how many organizations can we ultimately serve? Is it greater than 17, equal to 17, or less than 17? The answer is equal to 17, but as another trick question, there are truly many more ways that our students are emerging as leaders, serving the greater community, that aren't even figured into this equation. So finally, last question. Raise your hand if you know what April 2nd is. Terrific. April 2nd is Pledge Day for our Connected campaign. We're about to make history again on April 2nd. We already know the Capital campaign will be the largest and most successful in the history of St. James. It will touch future generations of the church and school for years to come. So thank you, St. James. Thank you to the parishioners who took a leap of faith in 1982. And thank you to all of you who have joined this church in the last 35 years. We are now ready to become part of history in the making again. Thank you for fostering a home that has helped to create students who truly love learning, ones with compassion and a belief in service beyond self, and ones who are our future of our church and this community. Thank you.
Thank you, Stacy and Bonnie. A few more announcements. Number one is that there is a handout about the Connected campaign. Make sure you read it and add to your information about it. And there are two books. There are two books in the back. One is free, published by the Forward Movement, which is free for Lenten devotions. The other one does cost $5. It's by the Forward Movement as well, and it's an excellent devotional. The third thing that's being offered, the primary offering, is this course that we're doing on learning more about Jesus and Holy Week. And if you haven't gotten the insert about that, there's more information that's been mailed out. There's more information back there for it. But if you're not signed up for the 11:45 course, come and join us. And you may like it. You may want to stay. So God has called us together. This is the first Sunday of Lent, and as I said earlier, we're going to begin it in a dramatic way to remember that we are surrounded by God.
See you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose blessed Son was led by the Spirit to be tempted by Satan, come quickly to help us who are assaulted by many temptations. And as you know the weakness of each of us, let each one find you mighty to save. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.' But the serpent said to the woman, 'You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.' So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
After he was baptized by John, Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly the angels came and waited on him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the living God, who is Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, you probably know this, that the collect of the day is a collection of ideas that are that forms the theme of that Sunday or that day or that event. So it's a very important statement right up at the beginning of the liturgy to say, okay, folks, this is what we're focusing on today. And the collect of the day, I just want to repeat a little bit of it. Come quickly to help us who are assaulted by many temptations. I mean, come quickly. It sounds like, you know, an emergency. Come quickly to help us who are assaulted by many temptations. Throughout the day, all kinds of temptations. And as you know the weaknesses of each of us, God does know that. You can try to hide them from God, but it's useless. God knows who we are, both our pluses and our minuses. As you know the many weaknesses of each of us, let each one find you mighty to save. So the punchline is, God, come quickly and save us. Bring peace and truth into our lives. So, for 7 days, about a week ago, I went on a personal pilgrimage. Since turning 70, I went back to the place where I was born and the church in which I was ordained and the churches I served and all the houses I lived in, the homes I lived in. And it was a fascinating experience. I mean, so many memories. And some of those I treasure, and some of those I'd give anything if I could forget. But one of those memories actually has to do with this season of Lent. And it happened when I was 11 or 12 years old, and my friends and I were walking home from school, and we'd go by this little grocery store, this little neighborhood grocery store called Bristow's Grocery. And we'd always go in there and get something and eat it while we're walking home or go play baseball or something. And I remember somehow we started talking about church. I don't know why. I don't know how we got off on that. But all of a sudden, one of my good friends who was right here to my left, well, let me back up 1 minute. I mean, what we would get often was a Pepsi Cola. By the way, do you know what word uses the same letters in Pepsi Cola? There's another word that uses the very same letters in Pepsi Cola. Do you know what that word is? This is really deep, really deep. Episcopal. Yeah, Episcopal. And it just so happens that Pepsi Cola was invented by a chemist in New Bern, North Carolina, and it was right across the street from the Episcopal Church. Now, I don't know how it happened, but isn't that weird? Anyway, so what we would do after we would stop at this grocery store is often we'd get a Pepsi Cola and drink a little bit of it and then get a little bag of peanuts and then pour the peanuts in the Pepsi Cola. Is that crazy? I don't know why we did that. I don't know why we did it, but that's what we did. But my friend didn't do that. Instead, he had a Snickers bar. So there we were walking down the street, and we were all eating and talking. And all of a sudden, he stops and spits out on the sidewalk this Snickers bar. I said, Billy, what are you doing? He said, I gave up candy for Lent. Well, now, he was not an Episcopalian. He was a good Roman Catholic, so he's really, really serious about getting that candy out of his mouth. What a waste of a good Snickers bar. But Lent, you know, even though it might be helpful to give something up, maybe that's something that gets us to a place of making more space for God in our lives, but what this colleague says is that Lent is not so much about saying no to something as it is about saying yes to God. I mean, ultimately, that's what we're called to do, right? We are disciples of Jesus Christ. That means we are saying yes to following and learning from Jesus Christ. We are believers in God, so that means that what we want to do is to go deeper and deeper into that faith. It's a lifelong journey. But we want to say yes and yes and yes again to going deeper into that faith in God, the triune God, God the Creator, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit. And Lent is a great time, you know, we can set it aside as saying, even though we'd like to do this every day, but it's a season when we really want to push the envelope a little bit and really, really go deeper. Another reason is that if you're just going to, like my friend, give up candy for Lent, I mean, when Easter Day comes, you can say, thank goodness, that's over, now I can eat candy. But if you take on something new that's doable, that really does have an effect on you and maybe changes the way you honor and live into your relationship with God, well, that might continue after Lent. What a fantastic thing. What a fantastic thing. Well, that's what this gospel is about, too. Now, even the Genesis story and the gospel story, you might see it as a conflict, you know, between, in the Genesis story, who was wrong? I mean, the serpent, the woman, the man, you know, but that's really missing the point. The point is, they didn't say yes to God. That's the point. And in the gospel, you know, it's the same kind of thing. You could say, okay, this is a battle between the devil and Jesus Christ. Who's going to win here, you know? Who's going to, what the, out? But it really was not so much, because you could see that Jesus really deflected every time. And what did he do? I mean, he did not take the bait. He was not tempted. He was tempted, but he didn't go there. Instead, he said yes to God again and again. The devil says, hey, what about unlimited prosperity? Why don't you go ahead and turn these stones into food? I mean, think what good that would do in the world. It would solve hunger. But Jesus says, no. I'm going to live on God's word. Or What about, why don't you go ahead and throw yourself down and prove to me that you're the Son of God and that you'll be protected because you are privileged or you have this extra protection? And God says no. Jesus says no. I don't need to do that. I'm going to say yes to God. Or what about, the last one is that if you bow down to me, the devil says, all the power in the world is yours, Jesus says, no, I'm sticking with God. A dramatic story, but remember, if we're disciples of Jesus, what we're called to do is do what Jesus does, not be Jesus, but take steps and do relate to God as Jesus does, and that's the message for us here. Now, aren't we tempted every day? I mean, in a thousand different small ways, or maybe even some big ways. We're tempted to do something we know is not the right thing, but there it is. And sometimes we do the wrong thing. And then we have to ask for forgiveness, or we have to change our ways. But what if we found a way to be deeper into that faith in God, that maybe we didn't have to struggle with the temptation so much because we were more rooted in the faith? Here's something I want to ask you to do, not to give up anything. You can do that too. Whatever works to help you move deeper, that's fine. But I want you to say yes more to God every day. And here's something you could do. Either at the beginning of the day or the end of the day or whenever you want to throughout the day, you can say this sentence. God, I now put my whole trust in you. What did that take? 15 seconds. I mean, just, you could be at home, you could be here, you could do it right now. God, I now put all my trust in you. And then just be still for another 45 seconds. And then go about your business. But whenever you think about it, wherever you are, say that. You're not promising to do it all day. You're not even promising to do it for 30 minutes. God, I now, in this one little minute, in this safe place, God, I now put all my trust in you. And here's what happens. The more you say it, the more it is true. You know, we end up convincing ourselves. It's a good thing to be convinced of. God, I now put all my trust in you. We know that that's the message and that's the reality that Jesus will live throughout this season and Holy Week, to ultimate death. Jesus put all his trust in God. And here we sit as a result, in gratitude. So eat all the candy you want to, unless you have a reason not to. But please, do something to go deeper into that faith journey. Every year is important and every day is important. Tell God, God, now I put my whole trust in you. Amen. Will you please stand as you are able? The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace we are able to triumph over every evil, and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim your glory and name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God Almighty.
And so, Father, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving,
we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming.
Lord God, of all who have gone before us, God of Abraham, Peter, and Paul, God of Sarah, Mary, and Mary Magdalene, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only, and not for strength, for pardon only, and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name.
Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread.
Accept these prayers and praises through Jesus Christ our Lord. Our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
Behold what you are.
May we become what we receive.
Everybody. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. May God the Father, who does not despise the broken spirit, give to you a contrite heart. May Christ, who bore our sins in his body on the tree, heal you by his wounds.
Amen.
May the Holy Spirit, who leads us into all truth, speak to you words of pardon and peace.
Amen.
The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.